إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. Brothers and sisters, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah give us, all of us, sincere taqwa and a sincere and a real fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our heart. And pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah give us life to live as Muslims and give us death to live, die as Muslims. Ameen thumma ameen. Today's khutbah is the last part of our series that we were talking about, the seven conditions of La ilaha illallah. And today is the last one. And then inshallah, I will conclude everything that what we have covered in brief. And inshallah, the next Jummah will be all about Sha'ban and remaining of the Sha'ban and also the Ramadan, inshallah. So the seventh condition of La ilaha illallah is the love for the word that we say, the love for the kalima that we say, that with what love, with what affection and sincerity and devotion that we say this kalima. So love for that La ilaha illallah, and love for those people who also say La ilaha illallah. And at the same time, everything that is opposite of these seven conditions, that also have to be put into our consideration, because today is the conclusion of all these seven conditions. Number one, as you know that these seven conditions are the first one, as we learned, it is ilm, the knowledge, that every Muslim who says La ilaha illallah, he should have the proper knowledge of the La ilaha illallah. He should have the proper knowledge of La ilaha illallah. And the same thing opposite of that, which will reject our La ilaha illallah, that we say La ilaha illallah and we don't have the correct knowledge of La ilaha illallah. So this will be the opposite of the knowledge, the jahala. And the second condition of La ilaha illallah is that yaqeen. When you say La ilaha illallah, there should not be any doubt in your minds. It should be completely with certainty, you have to say that. And the opposite of that, opposite of yaqeen, is shak, raib, doubt. So that means when you say La ilaha illallah, that there is no God to be worshipped except Allah. And the opposite is that you don't have certainty. First of all, you don't have the knowledge of La ilaha illallah. Second thing, when you say that only Allah to be worshipped, you are not certain about what you are saying. So you are partly doubtful here and there. The three is the qubul. That means you have submitted it, you have accepted it, and the opposite of that La ilaha illallah is that you don't want to submit yourself. You say La ilaha illallah because you are born in a Muslim family, but you don't want to submit yourself to that. That means when you say La ilaha illallah, that nobody to be worshipped except Allah, and you don't worship Allah, that means you are not submitting yourself to Allah. The fourth one is al-inqiyad, following what La ilaha illallah means. La ilaha illallah means to submit yourself, to obey Allah's command, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to understand, to have the knowledge, everything is called inqiyad, submission to following that what you are saying. And opposite of that is all that you should be doing by saying La ilaha illallah, you do opposite of that, which can be mushrikeen, they do opposite of La ilaha illallah. It could be munafiqeen who are doing opposite of La ilaha illallah, and could be anybody who is, you know, here and there. So this is the fourth condition, that a person is submitting to what he is saying, and the opposite is that you do against that. Wasidq, the truthfulness of that. That means when you believe in it and you say that this is the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is the only the truth, there is no other truth beside that, then alhamdulillah, your La ilaha illallah is correct. If you say no, if I say La ilaha illallah to be worshipped, and then you have a doubt about it, then, and you don't want to accept it, you say, okay, maybe I heard this from my sheikh, or maybe I heard from Mulvis, or maybe I have heard from my father, maybe I have heard from my, but actually I don't know whether this statement is true or not, or maybe I don't know whether this has really come from Allah, or maybe I don't know whether this has really come from Quran, because you won't believe. There are people who are rejecting Adhan because they say that Adhan is not there, the words of Adhan is not there in the Quran. There is no Adhan in the Quran, there is no Adhan in Sahih Bukhari, so they don't want to believe in Adhan because it's not there. So they are people who say that. So there are people who even can say there is no La ilaha illallah in the Quran. And where did Allah say that these are conditions in the Quran? Where did the Hadith say that these are the conditions? So people will say, I don't know whether it is true or false. But as a believer, you should believe that this is the truth, and you should not belie it, or you should not accept the one who says there is no truth in that. And the fifth one is, the sixth one is ikhlas, which we have done last time. The sixth one is ikhlas, and as I said, that there are three types of people who say La ilaha illallah. One is the mushrikeen, they also say La ilaha illallah, but they were not sincere in their sayings. They have Allah to be worshipped and they worship other people as well. And munafiqeen, who said La ilaha illallah with their words, with their mouth, and the remaining conditions were not found in them, and they had hid, the kufr was hidden in their heart. And the third type of people are the true Muslims, who say with the mouth, who believe in the heart, and they apply it with their, you know, wings and their limbs, their body. The last one, which is today's khutbah, and this is also a final thing, and it goes back to our liking and disliking, our love and our hate. So the opposite, the seventh condition is love for La ilaha illallah, and those who say La ilaha illallah, and the opposite is the hatred towards La ilaha illallah, and hatred towards those who say La ilaha illallah. And today this is the only thing that you will find in the whole media. If you see the Hindus today, they hate Muslims because of this La ilaha illallah. If you see the Christians, we don't believe in Trinity, we believe in oneness of Allah, they hate us for that. We Muslims hate them because of this. We are not Hindus because we are different than them. We believe in La ilaha illallah, we have love for La ilaha illallah, and we have love for those people who say La ilaha illallah. So La ilaha illallah, now the fourth condition, seventh condition is love. Love for those who, al-mahabba. Mahabba li kalima La ilaha illallah. So those who say La ilaha illallah, the love is also for them. And what is, why this has become a condition? Because Quran does speak about that. That there was, during the time of Rasulullah, there was a group of people who loved Allah, and also they loved other gods. And if you read Surah Al-An'am, in Surah Al-An'am, Allah speaks about the sacrifices that people offer to Allah and sacrifices they offer to their awliya Allah. their false gods. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described in details, which I am not going to bring all those quotations, but in chapter 6, Surah An'am, Allah is talking about the cattle, the animals that are served for Allah as a sacrifice, and animal that is served as a sacrifice for the idol worshippers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran, in Surah An'am chapter 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that these people, when they were dividing the crops, dividing the animals, dividing the properties, dividing the sadaqat for Allah, they had certain calculation. Based on that, they will make a calculation for that. They will count it, okay, this many cows for Allah, this many goats for Allah, this many wheats for Allah, this many dates for Allah, this many vegetable for Allah. And they have also a certain calculation for Lat, Manat, Uzza, Wad, Su'a, Yaghuth, Ya'uq. And for today, we have got this mazar and that mazar, for this Baba and that Baba. Like, for example, sorry to say this, Rajab, which was the last month, we have a very famous festival among the Muslims, which is called 22nd of Rajab. 22nd of Rajab is a celebration, which is a feast, like a food celebration, and they call in Urdu language kunde, kheer ke kunde. And this is sweets prepared from the milk for Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh. Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh is one of the descendants of Ahlul Bayt. He is from the family of Hassan and Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhuma ajma'een. Now this Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh, he is one of the imams of the Shia as well. But this imam is the imam for the Sunnis. And they believe that when you serve food in the form of the kheer and other kind of things, on 22nd of Rajab, in his name, and if you wish anything in your life, and if that is not happened, if it doesn't work, then Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh has given his promise to the people that when you serve the food on 22nd of Rajab, kunde, Rajab ke kunde, if you don't serve that, and if you have served it, and you have wished something, and that wish has not come true, then you can catch my neck on the Day of Judgment. And for that reason, and this is not something new, I was 8 years, 10 years old, my family used to make that. And we used to wait till the utensils get empty, because it is they used to say that the one who empties the glass or cup, whatever, underneath you'll find some rupees. So we kids used to wait for that when the jug is finished, then we'll take the money as well. And this is very famous in our family. And those who do not serve, they say you are this or that, and you don't believe in that karamat of Sir Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh. And then you can check it. You tap on Google, you'll get this, what I'm saying. But this is shirk. This is shirk, because people, when they do out of fear. Then if you don't do it, you will be in trouble. Second thing they do is do this in the love of Ahlul Bayt. And Shias are happy with you, because this has come from Shias. You have to understand this, that this is shirk. And we Sunnis are celebrating. Shias are not celebrating this. This is Sunni who are celebrating this. And they do this for the love of Ahlul Bayt. And they do for the love for Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh. Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah alayh is also Ustad and teacher of Abu Hanifa. I'm giving you the background so that you will understand what I'm talking, where I'm coming from. So Jafar Sadiq rahmatullah is the main ustad of Abu Hanifa as well. So you will know easily, you will check it on Google, and you will know the history of this kunde. And you go back to it and compare this today. Because Muslims, Sunni Muslims, my family, my mother, my father, my uncles, my cousins, my aunties, they used to do this. And they used to do this with two intentions. Fear of them, that you will get cursed if you don't serve it. they will curse you. Jafar Sadiq Rahmatullah Alayh and his followers will curse you. And second thing is love for them. So if you don't do it, that means you hate them. And this idea is something which is mentioned in the Quran. So why I brought the example of Jafar Sadiq? To make you understand that when I'll speak about Surah An'am, big mouth will say, Allah speaks about mushrikeen. Why are you giving this example to us? No, this is there. In India, in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, in different part of the world, if somebody has made the oath that Allah, if this thing happens, I will serve my child for you. And there is a place in Pakistan where they put the live baby who is alive. They throw in the vessel, a big one, or the tank, where the food is served. And that is the oath they have made, their promise to this. And this is the sacrifice for that. Why? Because if a person, like a person used to have only daughters in his family. So a Maulvi Sahab or Peer Sahab told this person that you make an oath that this time if you get the son, then you will sacrifice either that son alive for this Baba, the one who has died. He has got nothing to do with that. But the Maulvis will make you do that. And they will say, then your next child will be boy and he will survive. So you sacrifice this, your life baby, for that person. That will be your oath. And they do that. And this is legal. And government can't do anything. Because government doesn't know that. Or maybe government is part of that Aqeedah. So they get scared of them. Maybe the Baba, the person dying is lying in the shrine, he might curse you. And these things are happening, and this is the truth. But I have to give you this example to make you understand that in the name of love, people who are Muslims, they do shirk. But that shirk is mentioned in the Quran where Allah SWT is saying that these people who used to have a portion for their wali, buzurg, or for their whatever they have, that portion is for them, and one portion is for Allah. And the one, when they are sorting it out, this is the point I'm telling you. When they sort that out, this much is for Allah, this much is for their wali Allah who has died. If anything is increased in the calculation, in the portion for their wali, they say no problem. Allah is ghani. Allah is, you know, self-sufficient. Allah doesn't mind for that. So that will let it go. But if they find that their portion and their certain calculation is less for their wali Allah, they will take Allah's share to complete it by saying, no, if this person gets angry, then I'll be cursed. And if this person is cursing me, then nobody is there to help me. Even Allah will be upset because he is wali Allah, he is Allah's friend. And this shirk is mentioned in Surah An'am. But when this example is given, people say, no, Rasul Sallallahu was talking to the kuffar. And that example was for kuffar. But today what we do, see in India, in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, the people who go to the mazar, wali Allah, what they do? They serve them in the name of Baba, in the name of Peer, in the name of Wali, in the name of Buzurg. And they do lots of sacrifice. And even your family members, my brothers and sisters, you still might be receiving the letters and envelopes from Ajmer Sharif. You still may be receiving the letters from Ajmer Sharif. And this Ajmer Sharif, what? It is a shrine of Khaja Ajmeri. One of the awliya Allah, may Allah have mercy upon him, and may Allah accept his good deeds. He was someone who, mashallah, from the Sufi religious sect, he brought Islam to in a peaceful way in India. But what the people are doing after him is not what he meant. But you will be receiving, still today, they will be asking for some donations. And this is shirk, because you are not sacrificing, you are not donating, you are not, you know, giving your food or vegetable or your animals in the name of Allah, you are giving it in the name of Khaja Ajmeri. And that's shirk. And you think, if you speak to your mom, this is shirk, she will say, hey, fear Allah, you won't be able to talk, you will be cursed. You will have accidents, you will have loss in your business, you will have problem in your life. Don't say that. And this is what we say. So this is love and fear both. Love and fear both. And these two things, love and fear, it should only be for Allah. That's the last condition of La ilaha illallah. So if that is the case, I'm going to bring one ayah which is common. It doesn't say anything about peer or wali or this and that. It says about when you consider somebody who can help you, and you're lacking towards that person, and you're lacking towards Allah, how is compared in the Quran, which is chapter 2, verse 165, Surah Al-Baqarah, which I'm going to read in the next part of the khutbah. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ. Please make the dua for the sister Shaista. Just now I have got the information that her situation has become more critical than last week, and she is in her last stage. Please make dua for her. Her name is Shaista, and make dua for her that may Allah give her, you know, peace in this dunya and whatever Allah meant for her in the akhirah as well. إن الحمد لله نحمد ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. So let me conclude briefly what I actually wanted to say about the seventh condition. Seventh condition of La ilaha illallah is the love for La ilaha illallah, L-O-V-E. That's a very famous one. You see all the posters all around here and there. So it is L-O-V-E. Okay. So this is, seventh condition is that when you say La ilaha illallah, your love should be for La ilaha illallah, and your love should be also for the people who say La ilaha illallah. And the opposite of that is hatred. Opposite of that is hatred, and hatred is defined as I said, fear and love for other than Allah. So that is that part of the opposite of this. And it is mentioned in the Quran. I gave you the example of Surah An'am, where Allah speaks about that they have shares. If the share is reduced for the peer and wali, they will take Allah's share and complete it. But if Allah's share is missing or less, they say, no, Allah is ghani, so Allah doesn't need. But see what happens here. Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 165. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ ومن الناس من يتخذ من دون الله أندادا يحبونهم كحب الله. And there are people amongst them who take gods, helpers, supporters beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it can be anyone. Okay? Allah is saying generally, يَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَاد. أَنْدَاد, also we in Urdu say أَنْدَاتَ, مَدَدْغَار. Yes or no? This is a Hindi word as well. أَنْدَادَ, this Hindi people they say, like a god or someone who helps you, مَدَدْغَار. So Allah is saying there are a group of people who take these people as helpers and supporters, and you know, protectors beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yuhibbunahum kahubbillah. Their love for these deities is same as their love for Allah. See, comparison. Now this love for them means what you, if you love Allah and you want to do something for Allah, you do the same thing for them because you love them as well. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّا لِلَّهِ. But sincerely those who love Allah, sincerely those who believe in Allah, they love Allah more than them. But also I'll explain to you, my brothers and sisters. This is my personal experience with those people who come to deen. Okay, though, like somebody was out of the track. He was not praying, he was not fasting, he was not, you know, he was all involved in haram. So he repented, or she repented. Alhamdulillah, may Allah accept that. But what happens? Ashaddu hubba lillah is taken in a very extreme, deep, extreme way. The moment this person, a woman who was a naughty woman, she became a practicing woman, now she'll be so extreme in her practicing, she will start looking down upon other women. And this we can see. Her tone will be different. Her approach will be different. Her akhlaq will be different. And this is not the deen. This is a deen of shaitan, because shaitan wants you to be an example for other people to see, look, if this is the character of this person after becoming religious, then I don't want to become a religious person. The same thing when a person was not on deen and then he started, you know, practicing, going to the masjid. Now all those his friends who are not going to the masjid, he will say, you are kafir. After growing the beard, he will say, oh, you look like a woman. You are copying kufar. You don't have the beard. Oh, your thob, your ankle will go to hell. Look, your garment should be above your ankle. And harsh with the mother. Mom, you are doing shirk. Mom, you are doing kufr. Mom, this is haram. Allah's. Father, harsh with father. Harsh with brothers and sisters. People who are totally away from the deen, they are worse against them. But they think that this is what Allah is saying. They are saying this is the seventh condition of La ilaha illallah. That you love those who say La ilaha illallah and you hate those who don't say. So we are hating them. No, this is wrong. And this example I wanted to bring to you, my brothers and sisters. The moment there are brothers who become religious, they should be more humble. They should be more loving. They should be more approachable. They should be more kind. They should be more helpful. They should be going to those people who are away from the deen. They should invite them. They should buy gifts for them. And they should be sitting next to the feet of their mother and father. Because they should know that now their mother and father might go to hell with that aqeedah. But only I can change them by Allah's help if I be good to them. Because the mother will say, think. My son was banging the door when he used to come or when he used to leave the house. But now he's sitting next to my feet. What has changed him? She will think. Your father will love you. Father will wish to see you. And father will say, beta, which mosque do you go? Who is your teacher? Let me go with, meet him. Because I have seen that you have totally changed. But no. Our attitude will make them feel, your teacher must be teaching you this. If this is your religion, keep your religion with you. You are shouting at your mother? These are the words from shaitan coming out of our parents because the way we behave with them. So, this ayah says, now pay attention to this. Allah says there is a group of people who have love for Allah and they have got similar love for their deities. So again, they are believers as well. Because Quran says, كَحُبِّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّ لِلَّهِ. And those people who are true believers, and those people who say La ilaha illallah, they love more Allah than anything else. And as I said that, does Allah want you to be harsh on the people? Answer my question. Does Allah want you to be harsh on the people? Does Allah want you to turn away the people from you? Does Allah want you to scare people for no reason? No, Allah is loving. Allah is peace. Allah's name is Salam. And that's the reason we Muslims greet with each other what? Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you. So this is Allah that is teaching us. And if you love Allah more, then you should be more loving to Allah's creation. This is the root, the fruit of this La ilaha illallah. If you don't have that, then your La ilaha illallah is not true for Allah and not true for His people who say it. وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا. See, no kafir, no mushrik. The ayah 165 Allah is saying that those people, those who have done the zulm And the first zulm is that you do the zulm on yourself when you are a bad character in the name of religion. Bad example in the name of religion. A corrupt person in the name of religion. A strong and harsh person in the name of religion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that is the zalim. So Allah doesn't say kafir, mushrik or non-Muslim. Allah says zalim. Zalim can be anybody. وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ الْعَذَابَ أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعَذَابِ. Those people who have done wrong to themselves, they will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. That these people that you are relying upon, they have no power, they have no deities, they don't help you, they can't help you, they can't see, they can't hear you, they can't even do anything. And Quran has given the example of these people. In Surah Hajj 22, chapter 22, last part Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that these people whom do you go and visit? In the shrines, okay, people will say, no, this is again for non-Muslims. No. Listen, Allah is giving us the example. Allah is saying that people who are buried in the grave and they are famous for their shrines. If the fly comes on the grave of this person and leaves dirt, in other words, S, on that grave, these people, Allah is saying they are so helpless that they can't remove the fly from them. So how can you rely your help on them and you are expecting, and Allah is saying, Da'ufa talib wal matlub. This is the Quran, Surah Hajj, chapter 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that these people are so weak that they rely on the weakest person who can't even move the fly that, you know, leaves the dirt on them. They can't help themselves to remove that. And so the one who is asking is also weak, and the one who is being asked is also weak. And hear this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. The power belongs to Allah. That means Allah has the power for everything. All is needed, what? That you turn to Allah. And this is the same part of hadith. Now, amongst the people who say La ilaha illallah, who is the greatest amongst the human? Again, those who say La ilaha illallah amongst the human, who is the greatest and the highest in the rank? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So our love for those who say La ilaha illallah first starts from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after Prophet, who comes first? Mother and father. Yes? Then after mother and father, children. I'm talking about the closest one. Yes or no? Is there anybody who hates his child? Nobody. So you love your mother, you love your father, after Rasul, and you love your kids. And then, I love Akib, mashallah, he's my son, mashallah. So you love your friends, you love your, you know, people that you know them. I wanted to see him, you know, smiling. So, because he was very stressed, I wanted to see his smiling face, alhamdulillah. And I love this young man as well, mashallah. Jameel, Wasim, Yusuf, Khalid. Mu'ad, mashallah. Okay. So, now read this hadith, what I'm going to quote to you. It is from Sahih Muslim, reported by Anas bin Malik. These are not my words. The criteria of La ilaha illallah. And this hadith, wallahi, the reason I kept this hadith for the last lecture of mine, with the seven conditions, I want you to start from today, reading the biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even before learning the issues of Ramadan. Promise? I'm not asking you to read about any celebrity, man. I'm asking you about your own Rasul. And it's not difficult. Everybody should stand. Alhamdulillah. and to make our brother Peter happy, after Rasulullah ﷺ, read the biography of Prophet Isa alayhi salam. So if they don't defend him, we will stand to defend our Prophet Isa as well. Yes? Yes or no? He is our Prophet, yes? He is our messenger, yes? So alhamdulillah, the way we respect Muhammad ﷺ, we respect Isa alayhi salam as well. So after learning this life of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, we should start learning the life of Isa alayhi salam. Then you can debate with Peter, no problem. You can, you know, catch him, take him around and discuss with him, no problem. But you have to learn about Isa after that. Okay, let's read this hadith. And Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu qala qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب حتى أكون إليه حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. لا يؤمن, and the word starts with Subhanallah, that I swear by Allah who has the, you know, control over my life. And these are the words of Rasulullah. Rasulullah is swearing by Allah and he's saying, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. None of you can be a true believer. None of you can be a true believer unless he or she loves me more than his father, his son, and all his people. So that's why I made this promise to you, that now, first thing, if you really love Rasulullah ﷺ more than your father, more than your mother, more than your beautiful wife and husband with green eyes, you know, golden hair and pink cheeks, if you love them and you like them, Subhanallah, Asif is smiling. Okay, mashallah. May Allah bless you all, beautiful women and beautiful husband, inshallah. Say Ameen. Come on, man. Alhamdulillah. I wish good for everyone. But this hadith is very serious, my brothers and sisters. Let me calm down and explain to you. This hadith is the criteria for our love of Rasulullah. This hadith, Rasulullah saying, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِ بِيَدِي. This is a swear of Rasulullah. He is saying that I swear by Allah who holds my soul. And then he says, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ وَالِدِهِ وَوَلَدِهِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. He cannot be, or she cannot be, a true believer unless he loves me or she loves me more than ahabba. This is in Arabic grammar. In English grammar, we say superlative degree in the adjectives. Adjective is normal adjective, then comparative degree and superlative degree. This is in Arabic, is of ahabba af'ala afdala. This is the best. It says that he cannot be or she cannot be a true believer unless he or she loves me more than his or her father, more than his children, more than other people around him. So my brothers and sisters, the love starts only if you know about that person. And that's the reason I said that, inshallah, from today, your first homework is that you, whatever the source you have, if you can't find it, I will send you the links. You can study about the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Alhamdulillah, that's your first step towards the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Second step of your love to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because I'm like a father figure to you, so it's my duty to tell you. Learning the biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will not help you, because Peter, he has done his PhD in Islam now and religion, so he is a PhD. He has learned about Rasulullah. But those people who learn about Rasulullah sallallahu wasallam, and if they don't practice the way he has asked us to practice, then we are not different than Peter. Sorry to say that. He knows about Muhammad sallallahu, but he is not following him. He is not believing in him as a messenger. But you people are different than him. You, when you learn about Prophet sallallahu, the second criteria is that you should be following, and you should be doing the way he did, and prove yourself to the best, and then you see, inshallah, how the changes will come. He was the best husband, proved to be best husband. he was a best guide to daughters. Prove to be best father to your daughters. Prove to be the best friend, Abu Bakr. Prove to be the honest man. People, even non-Muslims, used to put their assets to him. Be honest in your speech. Be honest in your living. Be honest and truthful in your life. Inshallah, follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You will be spending as if you are spending the life with Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Inshallah. Okay, my brothers and sisters. 7 conditions are completed of La ilaha illallah. It's all uploaded on the YouTube. Check it, listen to it, and try to, mashallah, help yourself with this. And finally, my brothers and sisters, inshallah, there are a few things which I want to announce for you that will help us with our iman. That there will be a series in the whole month of Ramadan in Urdu and English, which will be like 3 to 4 minutes, maximum it will be 5 minutes. Reminder in Urdu, reminder in English, and that will be a journey with Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. A journey with Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It will be the reminder for you that if you really, you know, take that hadith literally, the reminder literally in your life, you will think that you are spending and you are traveling with Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So inshallah, wait for that and follow my channel and inshallah follow that as well inshallah. Jazakallah khairan. Inna Allaha wa malaikatu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidul Majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidul Majid. And please make dua for the sister Shaista in your sajda inshallah as well. جزاك الله خير واخذنا الحمد لله رب العالمين واقيم الصلاه.